restore him wholly. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Turn your Bibles to the book of Acts, the 7th chapter. This is one of those words where you're like, all right, Lord, you got to talk to me.
Because
Bishop called me at 11:45 yesterday.
In the afternoon.
But it's all right, because the word is in you. But you also want to, you know, you can open a Bible and preach from anywhere.
Amen.
And it's all good, but I'm the kind that I want to speak for the season where we are. And before we get into the word, I would be remiss not to just share the heart of God concerning our country and where we're going. And what God is saying. I've been praying all week. And I just want to encourage the saints. What is God saying about this? What is he doing? And I've seen so much. And we're going to get into the word. I've seen so much on social media from both sides. And you can tell that the people are intoxicated. They are drunk off this campaign. Either one side or the other. And it disheartened me to see so many of the faith community take such a negative stand as it relates to fear. And the sky is falling. And y'all just get ready for doomsday. And I begin to ask the Lord, I said, Lord, where is America going? And, you know, personally, I don't agree with everything on both sides. But I said, God, what are you saying? And he says, I'm going to bring America back to her knees.
That's right.
He said, I'm going to bring America back to her knees. She has been drunk off of her pride, off of what she has accomplished and who she portrays herself to be in the world. This is prophetic, y'all. And he began to share with me that he's going to, through this season, the next few years, that he's going to bring America to her knees, and she's going to call out the name of Jesus again.
Amen.
And there's going to be some rough times as we proceed forward. There's going to be some hills and valleys, but I encourage you to find your way into Psalms 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High. Because after the storm comes, God is going to send a revival to this nation. And the churches are going to be filled again. Not because they want a house or a car or they want something tangible. But we're coming to a place where we want God.
Amen.
And America will come back to God. And if you use Trump, Clinton, Pokemon, Mickey Mouse, it don't matter. They're all in the hands of God. And I just pray that prophets will arise and spiritual leaders will arise and attach themselves to those that are running this country. Because what I'm understanding is in prayer, and we're going to get to the word, but I got to share this. We don't want to get to the point where our dislike or disagreement becomes dishonor. Where our dislike, our disagreement becomes dishonor. Because anyone we dishonor, we disqualify ourselves to pray for them. So if we want this country to move forward, irrespective of who's in charge, we must honor the position. Because if we don't, we have no right to pray. Because you can't pray for who you don't honor. Is that wisdom?
Amen.
And so we're recording this, and I just want to share this not only with you, but those that are watching, that may watch after this service, that we must guard our spirit as to what God is doing in the earth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. But revival is coming. These are the best of times for the believer. Because folk want to know, where is God in all of this? And it is our job to, as Bishop preached last week, is our job to make the difference.
Yes, amen.
And to make sense out of all the chaos and the foolishness that's going on. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I just wanted to put that seed in your spirit. Amen. Acts 7, going to read one verse and then we'll preach the rest. Because I was going to read verse 22 through 34 for context, but that's too much reading. You can do that at home. Let's go to verse 29. And then we're going to see what the Lord says. It's fun when you get those last minute calls.
But you also were.
Got to be ready. I was trained under that stuff. Y'all know. Lord have mercy. All right, verse 29. Y'all have it? Okay. Let's see what God is saying today. Then fled Moses at this saying, and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begat two sons.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen.
My subject this morning, as the Lord would lead us, is disappointed but not defeated.
Amen.
Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
I don't know what you're going through.
I don't know what you're going through.
But I'm telling you right now,
you
may be disappointed, but you're not defeated. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, let's be excited this morning. Life is filled with so much uncertainty. So much. It's a guarantee that what we experience in life will change. There will be ups and downs. There will be trials and tribulations. There will be triumphs. There will be tears. There will be laughter. We will experience all of these things. But the most frustrating experience in life, Elder Williams, is the aspect, Bishop, of uncertainty and not knowing what's next and not understanding what is God saying in this situation that I'm going through right now. There was a story where one person said that the enemy, Satan, was selling some tools. And he was selling envy, and he was selling jealousy, he was selling anger, he was selling all these tools. But there was one tool in the corner, it was worn out, but the price was astronomical. And the man said, well, sir, how much is this and what is it? And the enemy said that this is disappointment. This is the tool that is most effective in people's lives. Disappointment. Disappointment means, if you break up the word, this means, B-I-S, means to separate, to put asunder. An appointment means plan. So a disappointment basically means what I planned for didn't happen.
Amen.
Am I the only one that ever been disappointed?
No.
That you planned some things in life. You had a 5-year plan. You had a 10-year plan. You had a plan that when you got married, we would have 2 dogs, 1 cat, and 3.5 children. I could never get the 3.5 part. What does a half a child look like? 3.5 children.
Amen. That's right.
And we walk through life with our plans. The Bible says that many are the plans of a man, but the purpose of God will prevail. And so I'm not going to move ahead of myself, but I want to discuss just a little bit about this disappointment. It means that we have been separated from our desired outcome.
All right.
We put so much into what we expected, Bishop, what was going to happen.
Uh-huh.
We just knew if we put A, B together, that C would come.
Amen.
But we put A together, B together, and here comes F. F shows up. And we're trying to figure out, well, where did the problem come in?
Uh-huh.
And so we find in the text where in Acts chapter 7, Stephen is breaking down the authenticity of Jesus from Abraham all the way up until the point of his death.
Uh-huh.
Acts chapter 7 talks about the stoning of Jesus. And then and the people there, the Jewish crowd there were attacking him because of his faith in the Messiah, Jesus, the Christ,
Amen.
The Son of the living God.
Amen.
And so as the Holy Spirit gave him insight into the revelation of Jesus Christ, he showed them from Genesis up until that point the authenticity of Jesus. And I want to pull out something that God showed me in this text starting at verse 22. He talks about Moses. He says Moses was educated in all wisdom and culture of the Egyptians. He was mighty and powerful in his speech and deeds. And when he was 40 years old, he came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. Y'all know the story of Moses.
Yeah,
he was a Hebrew child, and the Pharaoh at that time said, all the firstborn y'all got to go, all the sons you got to kill them off, because anytime you see an increase of the killing of children is an indication that a deliverer is on the way.
Amen.
And so I'm giving you, this is prophetic, y'all gotta catch this, that anytime you see an increase of killings, an increase of murder, an increase of violence, that is an indication that the devil sneaked into the destiny of a people, and there's a deliverer on the way. Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor, there's a deliverer on the way. That's how you know something good is about to happen, when all hell breaks loose, when stuff just falling apart, you don't know what's going on. Owe everybody money. Just this break, that break. That the husband acting crazy, wife acting crazy, children acting up in school, but something good is about to happen for the people of God. And I've come this morning to encourage you that although you are disappointed, you don't have to be defeated.
Amen.
So Moses now has been trained in the best schools. Egypt University, Ivy League of the day. Know the dark arts. He knows the hieroglyphics.
Yes.
He knows the ins and outs of the kingdom. He had access, for he was a son of Pharaoh. He was adopted. One of the maidens pulled him in out of the Nile. Y'all know the story. Y'all know the story. Y'all get good word here, so I ain't got to get taken to Bible study and Bible school this morning. So he's poured out, and he's growing up, and he's trained to be a leader.
Amen.
He's trained in a pagan society to lead. And sometimes as believers, as ones who are called out, that God will use even the enemy to train you for him to use you against the enemy.
Amen.
That's how God works. He uses the base things of the world to confound the wise.
Yeah.
When we think that we don't understand what God is doing, what is God saying? Where is God going with my life? He's preparing you for something great. And so here we find Moses. He's been trained, and now he has come to the realization that these slaves are my brothers, that these people are related to me. What an awakening our community would have if we look out our doors and look in our communities and look in the society and look at you and say, you know what? You are my brother. You are my sister. I'm not in my highfalutin area of living, and you got to get the way I am if you want to be connected to me. No. You are my brother. And that's the spirit that has to come into the land today. That this is my sister. I want to see you prosper. I want to see you achieve. I want to see you excel. I want to see you meet the potential of your dreams. I want to see you be great in the land. This is the spirit that's going to heal our nation. That's going to heal our churches. That we're not, Lord, help me, Jesus. That we're not competing with one another, but we're uplifting one another, knowing that if I lift you up, if I get you to where you need to be, you love me enough to not to leave me where you saw me. That you're going to reach back your hand and pull me up so that I can receive the reward of the potential that God put in me. Let me slow down because I feel fire up here. So Moses now has awakened. He looked and found that my brothers are in trouble.
Amen.
We're going somewhere.
Right.
My brothers are in trouble. Something is going on. So there's something here. Let's look at this and check out how life works when God has called you to be a deliverer. Bishop Howard, when God has called us to make a difference, when God has called us to make a change, when God has opened up our eyes to see that our children's schools still have lead in the pipes.
Yeah.
Open up our eyes to see that they're still closing down our schools, but they're building jails. See, this is the kind of preaching that's going to bring the healing, because God has anointed us to speak to the problems of our nation. God has graced us and given us the power to speak truth in love. And so Moses looks and he says, there's a problem going on. And the Bible says in verse 23, he says that when he was full, 40 years old, a whole generation, the 40 years is a generation. A whole generation has gone on in slavery. A whole generation has lived and died. New people are born into slavery. We're looking at our society. New people are being born into drug addiction. New children are being born in dysfunctional homes and families. New people are being born in a system that doesn't want you to excel. But there is a deliverer in the house. There's a deliverer in you. God has called each sister out, and I thank you. I feel strength. God has put something down in you to deliver somebody else. Whether it's a city or block or if it's just your house, God has put the anointing to set people free down on the inside of you. If you believe it, say amen. The Bible says at 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, the children of Israel, verse 24, and seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed, and he killed one of the Egyptians. For he supposed, that's key there, he said, if I defend my brother, he'll receive me. The Bible says that Moses supposed in his heart, it was already planned. Remember we talked about plans? He had already planned the outcome. He said, if I help them, they will accept me. He said, if I go to their aid, then they'll realize that God has sent me to help them. But something about life is so uncertain. It changes so. Let's look and see what happened. In verse 24, he says he smote the Egyptian. Verse 25, for he planned, he supposed that his brother would understand that my help for you comes from God. How many people we try to help and they can't realize that I am an extension of God in your life? That I'm talking to you to save you from yourself. Here you are about to marry a joker that ain't got nothing to do with your destiny. Here you are about to buy something that's going to have you in debt for the next 40 years. I'm trying to help you. I purpose in my mind that if I talk to her, if I talk to him, that they will understand that this is God.
Amen.
Yes. Something about people.
Yes.
When their minds are made up.
Uh-huh.
When they've already reconciled, digging in their mind, that what I'm about to do is all right. What can you do? What can you do when they come into the church and you find out that they're going through a cycle? That every 6 months they on fire for God. Amen. And then the seventh month, here comes somebody talking sweet nothings in their ear.
Amen.
All right. Say so.
What do you do when you tell them, slow down? There's a cycle going on in your life. There's something going on the inside of you that's keeping you unstable. And the winds of life are blowing you left and right. Well, Pastor, I don't understand. You just don't want me to be happy. You don't understand. He loves in me. He took me to Chick-fil-A and he paid for it. You don't understand, Pastor. I've been praying and seeking God for a man. No, 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 no. anything more for the brethren. You saw her 3 miles away.
I'm going to leave that alone.
For he planned that his brother would understand how that God, by Moses' hand, would deliver them. Verse 25 says, but they understood not.
Amen.
Lord, how frustrating to lend your support. I don't know who this is for. To lend your life. Because when you are assisting people, Bishop, you are giving, I'm calling Bishop because he's in the hallway. I'm letting him know that he's in here with us. That when I extend my help, New Freedom, I'm extending my life.
Amen.
We are lending. Sister Robin, will you take care of Mother? You are lending your life.
Amen.
Part of your life. Bishop, when you take care of babies, you are giving them a part of your life. But how do you handle when they don't understand the value of your service?
That's right. Amen.
Children don't know what you're going through.
Amen.
While they sleep you up,
yes.
Saying, God, how we going to make it?
Yes. Amen.
God, how we going to find the ends so that the ends can meet?
Uh-huh. Amen.
You're cooking food, wondering, when is the next meal coming?
Amen.
They don't understand. All they got is their handout.
Yes.
Mine need $5. Daddy, I need $20.
Yes.
Daddy, can you buy me? Don't know that all night I've been seeking God. God, what are you going to do? How are you going to come through?
Yes.
God, how are you going to make this thing work? God, I need you to come through because I know you won't fail me. But right now I feel like Jericho. I feel like that the walls, like the Bible says, Jericho was straightly shut up, that no one could get in, no one could get out. The walls that I built to protect me are the same walls that are imprisoning me.
Yes.
God, help me to break free.
Yes, amen.
So the Bible says, verse 25, verse 26, and the next day he showed himself unto them as they were fighting each other,
uh-huh.
killing each other,
uh-huh.
selling crack to each other,
uh-huh.
lying on one another,
uh-huh.
snitching on one another,
uh-huh.
gossiping about one another,
uh-huh.
backstabbing one another,
uh-huh.
scheming against one another. The Bible says that Moses came, showed himself unto them, and said to them again, sir, brothers, men, and in our day I'll say family.
Broski.
Y'all brothers, y'all are connected not only by skin color, but by blood. Some of y'all will get this till 5 years up the road. But it's all right. Because this is prophetic. This I'm preaching for a season to come. So the Bible says, he told me, he said, man, y'all brothers, why do you wrong each other? You're already part of a system that's against you. What good would it be if we're already slaves for me to fight you?
Amen.
What benefit would I get? Will I get more freedom if I press you back? Will I get a reward for putting my foot on your neck to get a couple extra dollars? And all we are rich slaves. I know it's heavy, but this is what he gave me. Don't see me, see Bishop. She called me. He says, why are you wronging each other? But he that was doing his neighbor wrong pushed Moses out the way and said, who made you the boss of me? It's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. He said, who made you ruler over me? So hold on. We got a dilemma. So I'm coming to help you. I helped you. And now that I'm correcting you, you mad at me. That's just like folk. Just like folk. They all right as long as I'm fussing at Sister Toby. As long as I gotta correct Sister Rochelle Shane. You better go ahead, Elder. You better go ahead. You telling them the truth. Ain't that right, Bishop? You telling them the truth. You better go ahead. And then when it comes to them, I ain't seen you in 3 weeks. What we doing? How you doing? How you living? Who you living with?
That's right, amen.
Well, who made you the boss of me? Oh, but it was good for Sister Toby. Giving the word was good for your neighbor, and the word ain't good for you. I'm almost done. This is what he gave me. He says, the man says, you gonna kill me too? you gonna kill me too like you did the Egyptian yesterday? Uh-huh. See, when folk don't want to hear correction, they'll bring up something from your past to try to discredit the truth of the present moment. I believe I'll say that again. People, when they are corrected, they will bring up the past to discredit the truth of the present moment.
All right.
So, verse 29, Moses got disappointed. He planned, and supposed in his heart that he would go down to his people to help them, and they would readily receive the mission. That they would welcome him with open arms. We've been in this thing for 400 years. Ain't nothing getting better. Pharaohs are uprising and downfalling, and our condition hasn't changed one bit. Democrat or Republic, don't matter. Our condition hasn't changed a bit. Black man, white woman, polka dot, alien, it don't matter. Lord, I feel a witness in this place this morning. Fighting your witness. Fighting your help. Fighting your deliverance. Moses got disappointed because his plan didn't happen like he thought.
That's right.
And you'll find in our opening scripture, verse 29, then fled Moses. Our first point of application, when you can't change the situation that you're in, the first thing you got to do for your note takers is you have to let go. Let go. Let go. Not so much let go of the people, but the situation. Because right now, see, right now, and this is helping some leaders in here, and this is helping even some parents in here. Sometimes, Elder Anthony, the situation didn't get hot enough yet.
Uh-huh. Come on, tell it.
See, the problem didn't get hard enough yet to receive the deliverance that you were bringing. Sometimes you gotta walk away. And let it go and let the fire get turned up in their life just a little bit higher. Because right now, if you continue to move forward, you're going to rescue them, and they're going to be enabled and be looking for somebody to pull them out of every trial that they get in. But God says, no, 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 no. The first thing you do is verse 29, let it go. Let it go. Don't lose no sleep. Don't lose no hair. And for God's sake, don't lose no money. Let it go. Bless you, Pastor Shalee. Good to see you in the house of the Lord. So Moses fled at this saying and was a stranger in the land of Midian, where he begat two sons. And when 40 years were expired, they appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, an angel of the Lord in the flame of fire. Which there comes times, Deacon. I was real Baptist today. I stood here for a long time. They say Baptist preachers don't move.
They don't walk.
So I'm Pentecostal. I'm messing with this about. But the Bible says that after 40 more years, Moses is in the backside of a desert.
Come on now.
You can be so broken, so disappointed, Sister Robin, that you'll find yourself in the wilderness. Trying to figure out, what's my purpose? God, you called me for this. You called me to this. You called me for this. And who you calling me to, who you calling me with and for, ain't receiving it. So I might as well maximize my time. I'm going to go have some kids. I'm in the word. So Moses had two kids. He's in the backside of the desert because he's disappointed. All of us have experienced, trustee Elsie, that wilderness experience. The Bible says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. When I'm hoping for something, when I'm wanting something so bad, and it doesn't go my way, something happens on the inside. And so this is where we need God. Because disappointment was a tool from the enemy to destroy us. But it's really a tool from God to enlighten us about what's really in us. Because what's in you is going to come out when you're disappointed. Either you're going to say, Lord, I see what you're doing. That wasn't for me. I'm going to keep moving. But if you're throwing a temper tantrum and you the tear up furniture and you snotty nose and can't nobody say nothing to you and can't nobody make you smile. I mean snowflakes of sugar coming out of heaven. I mean manna with syrup and butter and cinnamon is on it. And you still talk about, that's all right. It's all right. You know it's good. You know it tastes good to you. It's okay. No, you're disappointed. God is trying to show you that you weren't ready to step out when you thought you were ready. You had zeal, but no knowledge. So after we let it go, we back up from the situation. The second thing, we find it in verse 31. You let it go. Next thing you do, Deacon, is look up. You look up. Look up. And when, verse 30, when 40 years was expired, there appeared to him wilderness on Mount Sinai, angel of the Lord, and a flame of fire in the bush. Y'all know the story of the burning bush. Matter of fact, that was the first time I preached here. I preached from that text. In verse 31, and when Moses saw it, he looked up.
All
He looked up. He wondered at the sight. And as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came to him. Uh-huh. See, when you're out there and you're so broken, and all of us have been there, and if not, keep living. You go to a place where you don't even know how to pray.
That's right. Amen.
You don't even know what to say.
That's right.
You didn't even have the mind to even call on God.
That's right.
You were so stewing in your own disappointment.
Yeah.
Stewing in your own feelings and your emotions.
Yeah.
And your thoughts became your preacher. And your emotions became your bishop. And,
yeah.
And you began to sit under the teacher of your feelings. And one day you happy, the next day you say, God, I feel the anointing in this place. Thank you for the witness of your spirit. And so now you're coming to a point to where you're not even talking to God. But I thank God that he loves us so much that when we can't talk to him, he will make it so that he will talk to us, that he will find us where we are. But you gotta look up.
Yes.
Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Look
up.
Look up.
Praise the Lord.
Let it go. That's time to look up. Notice in the text that God didn't speak, deacon, until Moses looked in God's direction.
Amen. Amen.
We looking at so much stuff. Should I do this? Should I buy that? Should I get in this business? Man, you need to come and join this business. And if you get five people, and get five people under them, and then get five people under them, you get $3,552.52 in 2 days. Because we haven't looked up. We haven't looked in the direction that God is in. We're looking at everywhere but God. But Moses is teaching us something. That when we're disappointed and we feel like we can't make it, we have to look in the direction that God is in. And that's when the voice of the Lord begins to speak to you and give you direction. Now we look at Housewives of Atlanta. We're looking at Husbands of California. Truth in hip hop, lies in hip hop, drama in hip hop. To counsel us in our relationships. Because we disappointed Mother Hicks. So somebody got to agree with what I'm feeling. Because he should have brought me the ring by now. I mean, it's been 6 years. We've been sleeping together. We've been having sex and fornicating. I feel my mantle now. So now, you know, by now, so I won't look crazy. You know, you should have put a ring on my finger. Now I bring it to his attention. And now he got an attitude. And now I feel slighted because now I'm thinking, now you're playing with my feelings. And so now we're gonna have to straighten this out. So instead of me looking at God, I'm gonna look at TV. Is this good, Bishop? I'm looking at TV. What did Boom Quisha do? When Big Mo did the same thing to her, what did she do? Oh, she cut his tires. Oh, she threw his clothes outside. Well, his clothes shouldn't be in your house in the first place as a woman of God. Bible says he looked up. When I couldn't talk to God, he started talking to me, Elder. He says, take your shoes off. because you don't even know where you are. Where you are is about to change your life. Can I get a towel? Where you are. Where you are. Did I eat it? Where you are. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. That's my fault. Thank you. Where you are. I don't look like TV Jakes this morning. He tells Moses, where you are, you on holy ground.
Yes.
He says, you're at a place where I'm about to change your trajectory. Because you were heading to a place of comfort. You were heading the wrong way. You were heading to a place where it was comfortable for you, where you have mastered sheep, and you mastered living in the desert, and you've maximized your time. You've cultivated your own innate skills and talents, and now you're comfortable. But God says, no, I didn't allow you to be born. I did not allow you to survive the killing of your brethren when they were throwing babies in the alligator, in the Nile, and feed them the alligators because they knew a deliverer was coming. He said, I didn't sustain you for you to be comfortable.
Amen.
He says, where you are is holy. Take your shoes off. Because I'm about to anoint you. To do what? The third thing that we do is look ahead.
Look ahead.
He says, verse 31, when Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight. Verse 32, saying, this is the Lord saying, he says, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled. Then said the Lord to him, put off your shoes, for the place where you stand is holy. I have seen. Isn't it good to know that we serve a God that can see? He's not blind. He doesn't need a stick in his hand while he's praying. He's like, hold on, baby. I'm coming. I hear you praying. No. God can see where you are.
Amen.
Not only can he see, but he can hear the cries of your affliction. Whether it's in your body, whether it's in your ministry, whether it's in your pocketbook, whether it's in your mind, God can hear you crying out while you're smiling on the outside. He can hear the deepest cry in your spirit. He said, I can hear you even if you don't open up your mouth. He said, I can hear your spirit crying after me saying, God deliver me. God set me free. God get me out of this mess that I'm in. God, if you empower me and set me on the right path, I'll walk it through for the rest of my days. He said, I'm the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. You're on holy ground. He said, I've seen the affliction of my people and I've heard their groaning. And I am come down to deliver. Speaking a new freedom. I'm speaking to this nation. I'm speaking to this community that God is coming down to deliver. I know what they're saying on social media. I know what they're saying on the news. I know what they're trying to incite. They're really trying to incite a race war. They're really trying to incite this foolishness to bring on another agenda. But we got to speak truth. We can't be afraid. Pastors and preachers, I'm not talking about here. I'm talking to those that's not here. That we can't be afraid to lose friends. You're going to lose some friends. I lost 30 friends on Facebook this week.
Yes, amen.
Ask me, do I care? Why? Because we have to let go. We have to unplug from the matrix.
Amen.
One day you're ready to march. The next day you're ready to put sackcloth and ashes on your head because you're looking at TV. You're looking at this foolishness and you don't well know whether to cry or get a gun in your hand and blow your own brains out because they're in you. nation needs to hear it. We need to hear. The saints of God need to be reminded that this is not our fight.
That's right. Amen.
Psalms 91 says, only with your eyes will you see the reward of the wicked. It shall not come nigh thy dwelling. I'm going to see chaos all around it, but it ain't coming no further. It's like the ocean and the beach. The waves come, and it got to come back. Trouble coming close, but it got to back up, because God promised me that he would keep that which I commit into his hands. And we got to be reminded that we belong to God, not the White House, not the City Hall, not the crack house. We belong to another kingdom, and our king, our president, is Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God. So the third point in application of this, after you let it go, because you can't change it right now.
That's
he says, oh yeah, help me preach. Yes, sir. You look up.
Look
in God's direction.
Yes.
Forget the chaos. God, what are you saying?
That's right.
I'm looking for God in this. When I came here and I talked to Bishop, we talk all the time about this transition. I got friends that, man, you need to look out. You need to watch out. You need to know the devil mad. You know the devil. I said, man, I'm looking for God. I'm looking for God. To hell with the devil. I'm looking for God. I ain't cuss. To hell with the devil. That's where he is, and that's where he belongs. To hell with the devil and his junk. I'm looking for God, and when I find him, I shall be made pure. That's poor cold. When he comes with your porch, that's all.
That's right.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm looking for God. Come on, tell other neighbor, I'm looking for God. I know it's hard, I know it's tight. If folk really knew what you were going through, they'd be in tears right now. But because God has undergirded you, because God has lifted you up. Moses, you are disappointed, but you're not defeated.